functional dystonia is a particular cause of dystonia that's probably more complicated to explain than most other forms of dystonia. Functional dystonia has previously been called psychogenic dystonia. The reason why the name has been changed is that psychogenic dystonia suggests that the problem is a psychological one. Now, even though psychological factors may be important in functional dystonia, the suggestion that only psychological factors are important is something which is not true. And also, the term psychogenic, to many people hearing it, either patients or relatives or society at large, seems to sometimes somehow suggest that the problem is not real or is imagined or put on, which is completely not what functional psychogenic dystonia is all about. So nowadays, people have switched generally to talking about functional dystonia. So functional dystonia is really a problem with the way that people can access or control their bodies normally. So it's not a problem with the basic wiring of the nervous system, which is what causes most types of dystonia. In functional dystonia, the basic wiring of the nervous system is okay, it's functioning normally. And the person themselves is trying as hard as possible to move normally. So this is not a problem with will or with not wanting to move normally. But what seems to happen is that when the person tries to tell their body to do something, even though it's wired up okay and can move, doesn't move in the way that they want it to. And in people with functional dystonia, people develop abnormal postures of the limbs. It's something which seems to, in some people, be triggered by health events of different sorts, particularly injuries and accidents. So painful injuries to the limbs seem to be an important way which, for some people, set off their functional dystonia. Now, those injuries to the limbs don't cause lasting wiring or mechanical damage, but somehow they seem to set off an abnormal learned pattern of movement, which then becomes stuck and very difficult to change. And often that's associated with quite a lot of pain. So there's a type of functional dystonia, which is sometimes called fixed dystonia, where typically after injury, people develop a fixed dystonic posture of the limb and often a lot of pain, sometimes to the extent that the limb can't even be touched, it's so painful. There are some people who develop attacks of dystonic movement, which are also another way in which functional dystonia can show itself. The diagnosis of functional dystonia is quite complicated and really needs the help of a movement disorder specialist who really knows dystonia well and can tell the difference between functional dystonia and other causes of dystonia. Understanding the diagnosis is difficult, and often people get the impression they're being told by their doctor that there's nothing really wrong or that the problem is all in the mind. The reality of it is that this is a complicated problem that sits in at the interface between neurology and psychiatry. And the reason for saying that is that for a proportion of people who develop functional dystonia, there are important background psychological stresses and difficulties which seem to make people more vulnerable to developing the problem in the first place. And that's important because sometimes that can be an important part of treatment. So if we think about treatment, that starts with getting a good understanding of what the diagnosis is and what it isn't. And as I've said, that can be quite complicated and take some time. Then it's about really taking a rehabilitation approach to the problem. So generally speaking, surgery and drugs are not useful treatments for people who have functional dystonia. The main treatments that can be useful are to use rehabilitation to try and relearn control over the body, over the movement of the body, and also to think about other factors that may be making the situation worse. So for example, in people who've had long-term disability from functional dystonia, working with an occupational therapist to help regain function again, learn how to do things again. And for some people, psychological factors are important as well, either as things that have triggered off the problem or things that have developed since the problem's been there. And in that case, involvement of a clinical psychologist or psychiatrist, again, ideally who understands about functional dystonia, can be a useful part of treatment. And sometimes having all of that sort of rehabilitation together in what's called multidisciplinary rehabilitation can be a useful way to try and help. Functional dystonia is not a very common form of dystonia. In dystonia clinics, it would probably account for about maybe 5% up to 10% of the patients that are being seen there. So it's a condition which movement disorder neurologists, particularly those interested in dystonia, would certainly come across on a fairly regular basis, but something where people outside, doctors outside of that setting, might not have come across it before and not be aware of it. Functional dystonia is part of a much broader range of neurological symptoms called functional neurological disorder, where people can develop different types of neurological symptom, but from the same process that's been going on in the brain, where people have lost access to or lost control over the body. Functional dystonia, some of the treatments that are commonly used for other forms of dystonia are not effective, and that includes deep brain stimulation surgery. So it is quite common for people with functional dystonia to be referred through for consideration of deep brain stimulation surgery, often because symptoms are so severe, but it is a treatment which doesn't help and obviously can also do harm because it's just not the right treatment for the condition.